Good morning, church family. It is great to see you here this morning. I trust that you had a great Thanksgiving. I've asked several of you, and so far nobody said that it was a horrible day for them, so I think we have something else to give thanks for, but it is great to see you here this morning. As we now transition from Thanksgiving into looking towards Christmas, we can look forward to the hope that we have in the birth of Christ. So let's stand as we begin our time of worship through music and sing Jesus, Hope of the Nations.
Jesus, hope of the nations, Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness, Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's life on earth. In history you lived and died, you broke the chains, you rose to life. You are the hope living in us, you are the rock in whom we trust, you are the circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history you lived and died, you broke the chains, you rose to life. You are the hope living in us, you are the rock in whom we trust, you are the assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart, not be all else to me, save that thou.
listen to the words of Isaiah 9, verse 2. It says, "The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Those who live in a dark land, the light will shine on them." This is the first day of Advent, and today we light the candle of hope. Advent is a time of waiting, a time of hoping. Those who were living in darkness remember God's promise and wait for the birth of Jesus the Messiah. And through God's promise, Jesus brings peace, and that gives us hope. And through Jesus, we have salvation, and that gives us hope. And just as Israel looked forward to the birth, the advent of that Messiah, we who are the redeemed look in a great anticipation and wait for the second coming of Christ. So join as we sing, O come, Emmanuel.
Church family. Thank you for that. Hey, isn't it great to see what God's still doing around the world? And as we were sitting there watching, Joe whispered over to me that lady, I don't know if you noticed, an older lady in India has been there for 40 years now and still going strong, serving Christ and reaching people there in India. And praise God for these missionaries who are so faithfully serving Him, whether a short time or a long time. Whatever God has for them. So let's be faithful in supporting them. I want to turn your attention this morning to the book of Isaiah, chapter 2. Isaiah chapter 2, and we're going to look at the first five verses together this morning before we go to the Lord in prayer. Isaiah chapter 2, we'll begin at verse 1. The word which Isaiah the son of Amoz saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. Now it will come about in the last days, the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains, and will be raised above the hills, and all the nations will stream to it. And many peoples will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us concerning his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For the law will go forth from Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. And he will judge between the nations and will render decisions for many peoples. And they will hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not lift up sword against nation, and never again will they learn war. Come, house of Jacob, and let us walk in the light of the Lord."
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Steve, for leading and reading for us this morning. Well, your Bibles should still be open to Isaiah, the text that we read a moment ago. We are, for the next few Sundays, building through the Advent season here. We're going to make our way through some select passages in the book of Isaiah as they look forward to the Advent, the coming of Christ, and we'll be looking at it from kind of all different angles as we have opportunity, but tie it into these themes that we see of hope and love and joy and peace and how they speak to us during our own day and time as well. So we're in Isaiah 2, as we said, and this morning we're looking at these first five verses in this passage. As you know, today we've of course kicked off two special emphases in our church for this season. The first, which we've already alluded to, is the Christmas season. You can see the red and the green and the gold decorations, the trees and the wreaths that are beautiful. Chances are you have some of these up in your own homes as you get into the mood and the spirit of the season. In the church, of course, as we've said, we refer to this as Advent. When we think about the arrival of Christ, we think in particular about his first advent, born of a virgin, laid in a manger, sought by shepherds, and worshipped by the angels. But this is not just a time to think about the first advent of Christ. It is also a time and a season when we think about the second advent of Christ. A day that is coming when Christ will not be wrapped in swaddling clothes, but when Christ will be wrapped in majesty and glory and power. And he will come not just in the sight of a few shepherds, but he will come in the sight of the entire world. And so that's the first seasonal emphasis that we'll see this morning, Advent. The other emphasis that we just prayed about and saw the video on is our missions offering, Lottie Moon. Joe's already explained what that is. If you're visiting, hopefully you got a glimpse of this. It's what we do as Southern Baptists. It's the main way we support missionaries. We support some specifically out of our church. There's families that benefit from that giving. But it also goes to help 3,000 other missionaries from sister churches who take the gospel to the ends of the earth. Every penny goes to print Bibles and fund hospitals and send missionaries and see to it that the gospel goes to the ends of the earth. And so those are the two emphases you've already heard about. Advent and Lottie Moon. Now, I don't know which Southern Baptist decided to put these two together, but can I just say it was brilliant? It's brilliant for a very practical reason, you can imagine. Christmas is the season of giving. And if we're going to open up our wallets and get out our checkbooks or log into PayPal or whatever we do these days, this is the thing to give to. As Christians, as believers, there's no greater cause to put our money to than, as Paul said in Philippians, to be partners in the spread of the gospel. But I also want to argue that it's brilliant to put these two together, Advent and Lottie Moon. It is brilliant because I think that is exactly what God does in Scripture. And that's what we're going to see this morning on the first Sunday of Advent. As we look at the theme of hope, we're going to see how God puts these together in Isaiah chapter 2. Now, Isaiah was written some 700 years before Jesus was born. That's important to everything we're going to look at. And whenever Isaiah and any of the prophets, really, whenever they talked about the future, they did it in a way that's a little bit confusing. Now, this is why some of you in your Bible reading plans, you're doing fine until you get to Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel, and then you just, you don't quite know what to do with it. It's a little bit intimidating to read. One of the reasons is this. When the prophets talked about the future, they talked about the immediate future and the distant future and the far-off future like it was one future. Imagine having three strings in your hand. They're all three purple. One's 3 inches, one's 9 inches, and one's 24 inches. And you take those three strings that are all purple but of different lengths, and you rub them together like this. And then you try to look at it and make sense of it. Right? You can kind of tell, oh, I think that's the end of the small one, and that's where this one begins. And if you start to pull on it, they all kind of pull each other. That's what the prophets do with the future. They talk about stuff that's short and medium and long, but they kind of jumble it up together. And so it can be difficult sometimes to work through this. But one thing that is clear in the prophets is this, that all of these tangled up timelines focus on two realities. The reality of God's king and the reality of God's kingdom. The reality of God's king and God's kingdom. Now, my point this morning, in all of this, my point is this. Just as we put Christmas and Lottie Moon together, so too the prophets put the coming of God's king and the coming of God's kingdom together. In other words, the prophets, they didn't talk about Advent without also talking about the nations. And we really should not talk about Advent either without also talking about the nations. No offense to Frank Sinatra and Michael Bublé, but the incarnation, the Advent of Christ is not simply about having a merry little Christmas. The Advent of Christ is a cosmic moment in in all of human history that has global, massive, universal implications. And so the idea of Christ's Advent is not something that's merely nostalgic. It should be something that is deeply theological and that really tilts and turns and changes how we think about the world in which we live. And this passage this morning, Isaiah 2, is a classic example of this. In fact, I would argue that what we find in this text here is that Isaiah is basically telling us this, that Christ will come into the world so that the world might come to Christ. Christ will come into the world so that the world might come to Christ. Now, you may say, now, preacher, now, wait a minute, time out. Are you talking about the first Advent or the second Advent? And the answer is yes. Remember the strings? We got them all jumbled up here. And there is a sense in which that Isaiah is seeing all of this intertwined, and while he speaks of one, he also speaks of the other. And I think there's a sense in which when we read Isaiah, and especially Isaiah 2, some of you will read this and you will only think end times, but you should also think Christmas time. And we need to make sure that we see the long view, the future that Isaiah saw, both in the immediate future, the distant future, and what was far off. And what Isaiah sees in this vision, he sees hope. He sees the hope of Advent, which is the hope of the nations. And the realization that the hope of Advent is the hope of the nations is what should give us hope this morning. And so that's the message of Isaiah 2 that we're going to look at, the hope of Advent. So in this passage in Isaiah chapter 2, the prophet's going to show us what Advent, the Christ Advent means. Now again, I want you thinking in two, like bifocals, okay? Think about one perspective and then think about the other perspective. And keep them both in view as we read this passage. First of all, in verses 1 and 2, Isaiah teaches us that the nations, that because of Christ's advent, his advent means that the nations will know that our God is the God. The nations will know that our God is the God. Notice verse 1, the word which Isaiah the son of Amoz saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. Now, this little phrase here introduces Isaiah's second sermon. His first sermon is the one that you have in chapter 1. Now, we're not going to go back and read all of chapter 1, but just if I'll give you this short version of it here, Isaiah's sermon, his very first sermon, Isaiah chapter 1, it did not go over very well. The basic sermon that he first preached was, God is fed up with you guys. God has had enough. And you can imagine why that wasn't a great first trial sermon, you know, for the prophet. So he preaches this sermon that basically says, God is fed up with your sin and your rebellion. And so his first sermon is kind of doom and gloom, if you know chapter 1. But now as we come to chapter 2, it's as if he balances that out. that Isaiah is reminding us that the same God who comes to destroy is also the God who comes to deliver. And he wants us to realize that God is the author of both. And so he says that this is the word which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. What did he see? Verse 2. Now it will come about that in the last days. Now just pause there for a moment. Notice the certainty with which Isaiah speaks. He doesn't say, verse 2, it might come about, it should come about, it could come about. He says in verse 2, now it will come about. He speaks in such a certainty. This prophecy, this vision, everything we're about to read, this is not just on Isaiah's Christmas wish list like a five-year-old. Well, I hope I kind of wishing for that. No. Isaiah is certain. It's as good as done. This is where everything is headed, and this is where it's going to go. And he says, now it will come about that in the last days. Now that's an important phrase, right? In fact, I hear that question all the time. Pastor, are we in the last days? Are we in the last days? Well, according to Peter, we have been in the last days since Jesus. If you go read Acts chapter 2, that's exactly Pentecost. That was his sermon. We're now in the last days. In fact, what's kind of interesting is if you read John closely, remember what John said? He said, little children, it is the last hour. Well, it's further than that, right? Most hours have 60 minutes. This hour has 2,000 years in it. I'm not sure how that works, but so be it. We are in the last hour, he says. And so there is a sense in which the whole time period, watch this, between the first advent and the second advent, that whole time period, the Bible labels it as the last days. And it's what holds the advent together, is this idea of the last days. Now, when we hear that phrase again, we instantly think, oh yeah, the future. We look forward. But when Isaiah said this, and when his hearers heard this, they might have heard something a little bit different. Let me kind of explain it this way. When most of us think about life, right, if that is the future, right, that's the past timeline, okay? When we think about most of us, we start over here, and what do? Most of us walk forward. Right, we move forward to the future. That's the direction that we go, and our back is to the past. And occasionally we might look over, right, in history class when you have to look over, but mainly we're doing this. The prophets did something totally different. The prophets, if you read them closely, they looked at the past and slowly inched into the future. That's how they calibrated their steps. Was by looking at what God had done and thinking about what God had done, and with their view firmly fixed in that, then they started moving in that direction. And so when Isaiah says, this will come about in the last days, he's not just looking that way, he's actually looking that way. You say, how is that possible? Genesis 49. You don't need to turn there, just listen or write it down. In Genesis 49, this is the first time that phrase shows up in the Bible. It's when Jacob, whose name was Israel, remember, his name was changed. When Jacob, at the end of his life, he called the 12 sons to him and the 12 tribes, and he began, it says he would pray for them. And it says in Genesis 49, he says, quote, I will tell you what will befall you in the last days. That's Genesis 49. And he specifically prays for them. And one of the groups he prays for is Judah. And he says to Judah, Judah, out of you is going to come the scepter. In other words, the king is going to come. The crown will show up in Judah. The future king will come from your midst. And in Genesis 49:10, he says, and to this king shall be the obedience of all the peoples. So all the way back in Genesis 49, think about this, Jacob said, in the last days, a king is going to come to Judah, and all the nations will come to that king. So Isaiah here is not giving us a brand new vision so much as he is expounding on what Isaiah saw. He's looking this way, and what Jacob saw, he's looking this way, and he's inching forward. And he's helping us understand, so what does he see? Look what he says. It will come about in the last days that the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains. Now, there's several famous mountains in the Bible. We think of Mount Sinai, where the Ten Commandments came from, but this is not that mountain. This is Mount Moriah. This is the place where Abraham took Isaac to sacrifice him. This is where Solomon would eventually build the temple. Now, this mountain, the Temple Mount here, in terms of elevation, it's actually quite small. It's only about 2,000 feet tall. As far as hills go in the Middle East, that's kind of a pile of dirt. You know, there's a lot taller mountains in that region. But notice what he says here. This mountain, the mountain of the house of the Lord, where God's presence is, it will be established as the chief of the mountain. It will be the mountains of all the mountains, he says. It's sort of like saying, one day Sharp Top will be taller than Everest. Well, that sounds ridiculous. Like, how's that going to happen? Well, he's not speaking here topographically like the elevation will change. I think he is talking here about the spiritual prominence and the importance of God's work in Zion. That a change of status is going to happen in the eyes of the world. You see, in many world religions, if you think of this idea of mountains, mountains have always been sacred places to human beings. Go back and look at Old Testament worship. Remember, how did all the kings get in trouble? Because they didn't destroy the high places. Remember where the high places were? That's the little hills and the mountains where the pagans, the Gentiles, built their altars. That was considered a sacred place. They looked at those mountains, those worship places, like we do steeples. Like, that's a high place, that's an elevated place, that's a place of prominence. And so they would have that. In Greek and Roman mythology, do you remember where Zeus and the gods lived? They lived in the mountains. Even today in Buddhism and Chinese religions, there's a belief of many that high places, mountains, are sacred. And to climb them is an act of achievement and spiritual enlightenment. In fact, I'm a big documentary buff. I love watching people climb, you know, the stories of people climb Everest. And they'll have people on there who are like complete and total agnostics, and they'll get to the peak and come back and go, that was a spiritual experience. Right? We tend to think of that as like achievement and accomplishment to climb the mountain. Isaiah sees a day coming when all the mountains of the earth, all of the religions, if you will, all the high places, all of those will be dwarfed. They will become an anthill compared to the chief mountain of God, because the house of the Lord, the place of God, will rise above it. It will have a new prominence over all these things. By the way, Isaiah wasn't the only prophet to see this. You remember Daniel's vision? The vision of the statue with the gold and the silver and all that kind of stuff. And we saw that, right? Remember that statue? The most important part of that vision, by the way, wasn't the statue. Remember what it was? It was the rolling stones. No, just one stone, not stones, plural. There was a rolling stone. And what did the stone do? It says in Daniel chapter 2, but the stone that struck the statue became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. And so Nebuchadnezzar concluded, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which will never be destroyed. And so he sees, even Daniel saw this reality coming of a mountain springing up from Zion that would fill the whole earth. And so, my friends, the advent of Christ to rule over the nations is not just Nebuchadnezzar's dream, and it was not just Isaiah's vision. It is God's promise. This is where it is going and what God is doing. And he says at the end of verse 3, and all the nations, when the mountain is lifted high, notice, all the nations will stream to it. Now look at that closely. That's a weird picture. You notice that? See, the last time I checked, rivers flow downhill. They don't flow uphill. But Isaiah sees this river of people, this stream of men and women from every tribe and tongue, they're actually flowing backwards, if you will. Isaiah sees that God is going to do something miraculous. That in the advent of Christ, God will do something that defies logic, something that defies sort of conventional thinking as the nations come to him. They'll abandon their high places. They will leave their places of enlightenment, their mountains, their places of achievement, and instead they will come and be, as it is, magnetically drawn to Zion. They will come to worship the Lord. And so Isaiah sees here that one day the nations, that they will come to know that our God is the God. By the way, this whole picture gets picked up later in John chapter 4. Do you remember John 4? Jesus meets a lady from the nations, right? The Samaritan lady. And they're having a conversation, and she says, it seems to me that you're a prophet. You seem to know stuff that other people don't know. And so she asked him, she said, our fathers, they worship in this mountain, but you people, right, the Jews, you guys say you have to worship in that mountain, Mount Moriah, down at the Temple Mount. And she basically punts the question to Jesus, you're the prophet, which is it? Is it this mountain or that mountain? Which place is it? And Jesus says salvation is from the Jews, but salvation is not just for the Jews, because God is looking for true worshipers. And they will worship him not in this mountain or that mountain, but they will worship him in spirit and in truth. In other words, it doesn't matter what mountain they live on. That from whatever mountain they are, they will see and know the glory of God and of Christ in his advent. And so, my friends, Christmas time, listen, is not just a season that says, let the children be glad. It is not just a season that says, let parents and grandparents be glad. Christmas is a time when God is saying, let the nations be glad. What did the angel say? I bring you good news of great joy that'll be for the Jewish people. That's not what he said. Good news of great joy which will be for all the people. And so, my friends, and not long after that, what happens? We see the wise men, the magi, men from among the nations streaming to find what? He who has been born the king. So they come streaming, following the star to find him. Brothers and sisters, do we understand that the colors of Advent are not red and green? The colors of Advent are red and yellow, black and white. That's what Isaiah saw. And the question is, do we see that? Do we think of Christmas simply in terms of sentimentality and sort of a seasonal mood, or do we see it as the outworking of God's cosmic plan to bring about redemption for the world? See, it's only when we see this and understand what Isaiah sees here that we can sing that song, Joy to the World. The Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. That's what the advent of Christ points to, that one day the nations will know that our God is the God. There's a second truth here in the text, number 2 in verse 3, he tells us that the nations will also obey God's word and reach others. The nations will obey God's word and reach others. Look at verse 3. He says, and many peoples will come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. Now look at that, look at the phrasing there closely. Many people will come and say, come. What Isaiah sees here is that those people who come to the mountain, those people who come and are transformed, they will then invite others to also come to the mountain. Those who have been evangelized, if you will, by this mountain, will become evangelists, bringing others to this mountain. Now, by the way, can I just throw something in here again? I think sometimes when we read this prophecy, and we read these words here about the nations, that again, we think of, we kind of locate ourselves at the center of this, and we look outward for the other nations and so forth. But can I remind us here this morning that I suspect that 99% of us in this room, we are the nations? Right? We put ourselves the center of the story. But Romans 11 tells us that, yeah, there were branches that were broken off so that the wild branches, the Gentiles, can be grafted in. And so let's remember that we are the nations that have come to him. And we are called now to invite others to also come to him. In fact, I mean, think about, look at verse 3 again. Many peoples will come and they will say, come, let us go. Think about this. What we are doing this morning by literally showing the International Mission Board video and taking up the Lottie Moon offering and talking about these things, we are literally seeing verse 3 happen. It's literally what we're doing. It is happening in our midst right now in some sense. That we who have come are now inviting others to say, come. Come and see our God, our King, the one who has been born. Why do we invite others, he says, verse 3, that he may teach us concerning his ways and that we may walk in his paths. Isaiah says that one day the Middle East will stop being a war room and start being a classroom. Right? People will not go there to fight, but they will go there to learn. They say that he may teach us so that we may walk in his paths. By the way, notice how those two go together. Teach us so that we may walk. May I remind you again, brothers and sisters, it is not enough to be a hearer of the word. We are to be hearers that become doers. And so it says here, he teaches us his ways so that we may then walk in his ways, that we may walk in obedience. If we can hear the word preached or hear it read and just kind of check it off the list and move along without feeling any sense of obligation or obedience or the weight of it on us, we have reason to be concerned. He said, these that have come to the mountain, they have seen the advent of this king. They will have the entire course of their life redirected. And they will think differently about how they will live. And notice what he says in 3, for the law will go forth from Zion and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Now again, notice that. The word of the Lord will go forth from Jerusalem. You say, well, preacher, is that talking about the second advent or the first advent? Again, I think it's yes. Right? Because think about it. I mean, you might have, he says here, it will go forth from Mount Zion. Some people seemingly think that Christianity is just like a European white guy's religion that started in the 1600s. That's just not true. In fact, if you get out a map, you'll notice that Jerusalem is not located in the Middle West. It's in the Middle East. It's an Eastern religion. And he says this is where the law will go forth from Zion. Maybe you've been born in the Appalachian Mountains, but my friends, your spiritual birthplace is Mount Zion. Hebrews 12 says, we have come to Mount Zion, to the city of God, to the heavenly Jerusalem. Maybe you've never gone to the literal Jerusalem, but if you have come to Christ, you have come to the heavenly Jerusalem that has been established in him. Now, the physical Jerusalem, that city was the launching pad. It's where the gospel began to go forth. Again, Acts chapter 2, the entire book of Acts. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. In the upper room in Luke 24, Jesus said to the disciples, thus it has been written that the Christ would suffer and would rise, and that repentance and the forgiveness of sins will be preached to all the nations beginning in Jerusalem. And so he says there, this was what was written. Was he not thinking here of Isaiah 2? Isaiah sees this great unfolding of what would take place, that God's word would go forth from Jerusalem and that the nations would be transformed. By the way, in some ways, he sees here an undoing of everything that happened at Babel. Remember Babel? What happened? The nations were dispersed. At Zion here, the nations are united. Babel was a place of confusion. Zion will be a place of education. Babel is where men will boast in themselves. Zion is the place where men will boast in God. Again, I take you back to John chapter 4. Remember Jesus talking to the woman at the well? She looks at him and she says, I know, verse 25, she says, I know that the Messiah is coming, and when he comes, he will declare all things to us. Look at verse 3 again. Who's going to teach? Let us go to the house of the Lord that he may teach us concerning his ways. Not the prophets will teach us, but the Lord himself. God will teach us. And the woman says, I've heard it said that when the Messiah comes, he will teach us. And do you remember what Jesus said? I who speak to you am he. I am the one you've been looking for. He is saying this is that moment already happening. Today, right now, we had the privilege of watching that IMB video, and if we could fly a drone over the whole earth in just a few moments, we would see men, women, boys, and girls of all different nationalities in China and Thailand and Sweden and Sudan and in Turkey and Germany meeting in churches and under trees and in shacks and little sheds, opening their Bibles to be taught the Word of the Lord. Doing what we are doing right here, right now, and we are one of the nations that have joined in doing this even in our own day and time. And he says here, the reason we do this is so that we might invite others to be discipled and to come and to know our God. And my friends, in that sense, Christmas is a great test of what Spurgeon said. Spurgeon said, every Christian is either a missionary or an imposter. John Piper said it this way, when it comes to missions, you have three choices: go, send, or disobey. That's what Isaiah sees here in verse 3. Those that have come to the mountain are now going out so that others can come to the mountain. My friends, Christmas time is a great time for us to think clearly on these issues, because the road leaving Bethlehem leads to Bulgaria and Belgium and Bangkok. If we can come to the manger this year or any year without going to the nations, we're not reading the prophets correctly. It's what the prophets saw, and it's what we should see as well. And so Revelation 22, what does he see at the end? He says, the Spirit and the bride says, come. And all those who hear say, come. And so all of us who have come to him, this is our obligation as we think of Advent. It is to do what Isaiah said, is to invite and call others to come to Jesus. You know a very simple way you can do that this year? Some of you do this every year, and thank you for doing that. Others of you maybe haven't thought twice about it. You see it and set it aside. I want you to seriously think about taking this, not right now, but taking this home from your bulletin. This is our prayer guide for the week of prayer. This right here is a very simple way that we can actually do verse 3. We can pray that the nations would come, that they would come to him and know him, that they might be transformed and changed and come to the same mountain, Mount Zion, that was established through the body and blood of Christ. That's what Isaiah sees. The nations will know that our God is the God. The nations will also know that they will obey God's word and reach others. And then third and finally, he sees that the nations will live in peace under God's rule. That the nations will live in peace under God's rule. Look at verse 4. It says, and he will judge between the nations. Now, the word judge here is not judge in the sense of punish or destroy. It means to arbitrate. It means to settle disputes. It means to bring about a resolution. Think about how many international peace treaties have been signed and written over the years, and yet they didn't last. Right? We try to arbitrate those things diplomatically, but they don't actually serve a purpose. But he sees here that in the advent of Christ, there's going to be a new kind of peace that will transcend treaties and transcend these diplomatic agreements, and they will bring about he will render decisions for the people. And notice what will happen in verse 4. And they, that is the nations, will hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. I love the imagery there. Isaiah sees a day without bombs or weapons or tanks, no threat of violence, no threat of terrorism, a day of peace where there's no unrest. I know that many of you in our church are big fans of the Second Amendment. I see it on Facebook all the time. I'm fairly fond of it myself, I guess, if I could say. But can you imagine living in a world where you don't need the Second Amendment? That's what Isaiah sees. A day when you can trust everybody. A day when there is peace among peoples. In fact, notice he says here, the instruments of destruction will be turned into instruments of human flourishing. They will hammer their swords into plows and their spears into pruning hooks. Instead of weapons, they'll turn everything into backhoes and tractors and shovels so that we can cultivate the land and we can bring about that which will benefit our neighbors for the good of those around us and not divide us and create more conflict. He says, and never again will they learn war. Many of you know that World War I, you remember when it was nicknamed? The War to End All Wars, right? This is it. This is the war. And after that, you know what they did? They established the League of Nations. And the plan was, we'll never fight again. And then what? Just a few decades later, a war happened, World War II, far greater than what happened in World War I. Human efforts to create this kind of tranquility and utopia, my friends, they never work. You know why they never work? They never work because of sin. Sin is infecting every heart of every man and every woman on the planet, and it's the source of our conflict. James 4 tells us that there is an inherent selfishness that drives us, and as long as that's present in the human heart, it's going to create these conflicts. But Isaiah sees a day, he says, be glad and be cheerful, have hope, because one day all of that stuff will come to an end. Do you know why we love Christmas? Because it's one 24-hour period of peace. Even your in-laws pretend to get along, right, for 24 hours. Right, we love that day, you know? But here's what happens. You know what? For 24 hours, everybody's good and quiet and calm, and on the 26th, we're fighting each other for parking spots back at Target. We're cutting lines for the exchange, right? It doesn't last. And so the first advent of Christ, it has this small effect that everyone enjoys. The world knows it. The world looks forward to it. We plan our lives around it. And Isaiah says that small taste is a picture of what will come when Christ will rule and reign and bring his peace on the earth. I was reading this week Article 16 of the Baptist Faith and Message. It's entitled War and Peace. I was reading it really closely. You know what we should retitle? I think it's a bad title. You know what we should just call it? Peace. It's really not about war. The whole thing is about the fact that Christ has called us not towards war, but towards peace. And it says, the true remedy for the war spirit is the gospel of our Lord. The supreme need of the world is the acceptance of his teachings in all the affairs of men and nations and the practical application of his law of love. That's exactly right. It's what Isaiah sees coming in the second advent, and it's what's already happening now, I would argue, in the first advent. You say, oh, wait a minute, we don't see this kind of thing right now. Oh, do we not? Do you remember the 12 disciples? Was there not a peace that transcended some racial and national and political barriers? Remember, one of Jesus' disciples was an IRS agent and the other was a tax evader named Simon. And those two guys got along. Look at the unfolding of Acts chapter 15, Jews and Gentiles, slave and free, Scythian and barbarian coming together, and there was a peace that transcended them. Again, even in our own midst, we see that peace. Why? Because Jesus not only said, blessed are the peacemakers, Jesus himself was the most blessed peacemaker. Because it was through his body and blood, through the sacrifice that came at his first advent, that he satisfied the wrath of God, that he put an end to war. The greatest war, the war between man and God. That we are enemies of God because of our sin and because of our rebellion, but Christ came to lay down his body as, if you will, an eternal peace treaty. And through his death and through his resurrection, he calls us to himself and he gives us a right standing with God so that we are at peace with him and so that we can actually be at peace with each other. And so if a man or woman walked in our church this morning from China or from Russia or from Nigeria or wherever in the world, but they are in Christ, my friends, we would be at peace with them. Because of Jesus. That is the hope of Advent. And so what do we do? Verse 5. Come, house of Jacob, He says, come, people of God, and let us now walk in the light of the Lord. Christ will come so that the nations will come to him. So walk in it. What does it mean to walk in it? I'll give you one last thought. You've heard it before, but I'll say it again. No one said it better than Oswald Smith did. We talk about the second coming of Christ while half the world has yet to hear about the first. Half the world. So if we have come to the mountain, if we have come to receive peace, if we have come in hope to Christ, it is now on us to turn and to say to others, come. Come and be saved. Come and be healed. Come and be made right with God through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. My friends, Christmas is not just about your immediate family. Christmas is about God's global family, celebrating that our King has come and that our King is coming again. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word this morning, and Lord, for the reminder of the hope that we have in the advent of Christ. As we remember his first coming, as we long for his second coming, Lord, we pray that we would walk in the light of the Lord. Lord, show us what that means in our conversations in the stores. Show us what this means as we interact online. Show us what this means as we talk to family and friends and neighbors, that we might be ambassadors of life, emblems of hope, and that we ourselves as individuals might say to those around us, come. Come to Zion, come to Christ, and be saved. Lord, we pray that we would walk now in hope for your glory and honor. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.